Hey guys, how's it going? Hope you're doing well. My name is Crown, and today I'm going to read you some very interesting stories that I hope that you're gonna love. And now, without further ado, let's go! I'm still in disbelief. Our neighbor in Puerto Rico, we currently live in the US, attempted to coerce my mom into allowing her son, his wife, and their child to stay in our home in Puerto Rico rent-free. Her son is the sole breadwinner in his family and is against his wife working. I believe his wife is content with this arrangement and even wants another child. Back in 2021, my dad had offered them the opportunity to stay in our Puerto Rican house rent-free, provided they maintained the property. However, they declined because his wife didn't like the house. Fast forward to a week ago, our neighbor called my mom claiming that her son had a witness from when my dad made the offer and that he now wanted to accept it. She also complained about the vines growing on the electrical wires from the light post, claiming they plucked a small street and that the property had been neglected for months. My brother, who lives in Puerto Rico and usually maintains the property, has been in poor health lately. My mom explained that she couldn't make decisions about the house since it belonged solely to my dad and would later belong to me and my older sister. My mom planning to move back to Puerto Rico after my father's passing and sell our house in the US. She asked for photos of the property, but she never received them. The following day, my mom called my aunt, who lives a few blocks from the property, to take some photos. The photos showed that while vines were growing on the wires, cars could easily pass through. Later, my mom discussed the conversation with my dad, who is bedridden and in poor health. He viewed it as a missed opportunity for them and didn't want them there due to their last interaction. At that moment, my mom asked my dad to call my brother, who is not biologically related to her. It turns out a few days earlier, the neighbor's son had confronted my brother when he was tending to the property and the vines, which he was aware of but hadn't mentioned to us. In other words, the mother had lied about the property being neglected. The neighbor's son claimed to have a witness saying our dad had offered him the house rent-free in exchange for maintenance. My brother remembered that day and their decision, which seemed to agitate the son. He then overshared about his financial and housing troubles, revealing that he was being evicted from the church basement where he'd been living rent-free for 2.5 years with his wife and child. They were supposed to save money for a house, which they hadn't. He expressed a desire to buy our house at a low price after my dad passed away. My brother, not appreciating the attempt to go behind my dad's back, bluntly informed him that he had no claim over the house since he was legally adopted by our grandparents, making him our dad's brother and not his son. He also suggested that it was time for the neighbor's son's wife to find a job, as their child would soon start kindergarten. The conversation led nowhere, and my brother left after clearing some branches and vines from the neighboring abandoned property. He chose not to tell my dad to avoid upsetting him, thinking the neighbor's son had gotten the message. Now the situation occupies my thoughts constantly. I can't believe their sense of entitlement over our house. This isn't the first time, but this attempt with a supposed witness was particularly audacious. My mom's eventual move back to Puerto Rico concerns me. I don't want him harassing her. Sometime later, and out of nowhere, this guy shows up, red-faced and ranting about how he deserved the house. I tried to keep my cool, explaining that the house had other plans and it wasn't up for me, but man, he was not having any of it. Then things got really wild. He suddenly lunged at me. I guess he was trying to intimidate me or something. But hey, I am not one to be easily pushed around. I dodged his move with a bit of a reflex action. I pushed him back. Oops, he stumbled over something and ended up back cold on the ground. I stood there for a second, heart racing, kind of in shock, like, did that just happen? But yep, it did. He was there on the ground and it was all too real. After making sure he was still breathing, didn't want any major drama, I called for some medical help. Talk about complicating family relations, right? But seriously, something had to give. His whole "I deserve your house" attitude had just gone way too far. Thankfully, no police were involved in this. I don't think they were going to make me the villain in this story, but it could have arrested him for lunging at me first, but We managed to get it done without getting the police involved. And for the time being, he just stopped nagging me about this house. I don't know what the future will hold, but I hope it's going to be quite peaceful from now on. I lived in a rural Midwest community. My now ex-husband and I had just purchased a 10-acre farm to grow his business on. We bought and sold livestock and needed the space. The first or second day we were moving in, my next-door neighbor stopped by. An older couple, which I later found out they were in their late 70s. The wife, who I will refer to now as Karen, mentioned the mud in the driveway and said the previous owners hadn't done anything to help it. She had mentioned that they owned a gravel business and she would send her son over to measure the drive and give us a good price for stone. We had moved some livestock into the barn already, which were 10 or so small calves and a couple horses. We were still readying the property for the animals, so at that point, they were secluded to the barn. Her son came by with a measuring wheel and gave us an estimate with a neighbor's discount. Oddly enough, the price was a couple thousand dollars above another estimate we had gotten. Since this was our first home and we didn't have a lot of extra money, we went with the other company. My ex-father-in-law was an equipment operator and had access to equipment, so he brought a dozer down and we had the stone delivered. About 2 days later, we get a knock on the door and it's a state agriculture inspector. She stated that there was a complaint made that we had several cattle that were recently brought in from out of state without proper transfer documents. We had to notify them where they came from and who our veterinarian was. I learned very early on in this business to keep very good records, so I had everything they needed readily available. I asked if she was able to tell me who the complainant was, and she said sure. And she showed me the name on her document. Sure enough, it was Karen. She came back the next day and stated she had all she needed and we were good to go. About a month or two later, we got a visit from the township supervisor. There was a complaint to them made that we had too many animals on our property and we were violating township ordinances. I told them that I had already spoken to him before we purchased the farm and told him our plans, and he said that it would be fine. He said it was specified in the ordinance and there was nothing he could do. He asked if there was a way we could acquire more land. Sensing he was suggesting something, I asked what he meant. He said the township ordinance states that if we have 20 acres, we can have all the animals we want and no one can do anything. We spoke to our opposing neighbor on the opposite side of Karen and we got a lease for an additional 10 acres that we didn't use but satisfied the township. Another week or so, and I got a visit from animal control. They got an anonymous complaint that my dogs were not well taken care of. He said that the complaint was they were super skinny and they would come back into the neighbor's house for food. Our property was on a main two-lane highway and we had the whole property fenced in, so there was no way they could even get to the neighbor's house. I showed him their food and water, and my door between my mudroom and kitchen was glass, and I had the dogs in the kitchen. He stated he needed to see them and check them out. I warned him that my two male dogs would lick him to death and jump on him, and he wasn't worried. I then said my female doesn't like men. She will circle around him and make some awful noises, but she's harmless. I opened the door and sure enough, the boys jumped all over him giving kisses. He rubbed down both of their sides and stated how well built they were and that they were some of the best looking dogs he has ever been called on. I asked if he wanted to see the female and he said that he was all good and there was no way he was touching that dog because she was doing exactly what I said she would do. I asked him if he needed to see my other animals and he said because he complained was about the dogs, he didn't need to. He assured me there was nothing to worry about and went on his merry way. In my downtime, I contacted a lawyer I knew through horses and asked if there was something I could use to help CYA myself. Once I told him I had 10 acres, he said that I'm covered by the Right to Farm Act in my state. I put my good old FBI hat on and began researching because I knew Karen wasn't done. I printed the 170-page act out and started highlighting how it would benefit me. I also did more research and found out the act supersedes any local governing. I decided I wasn't holding back and continued doing what I wanted with my property. We hosted a youth agriculture event at our home. We contained the event and exhibitors on our property without any issue. Everything was clean and organized. About 3 weeks later, we had also hosted the fundraising benefit for a close friend's son who was in a very bad car accident and was not likely to walk again. I made a Facebook event, this will be important later, and we organized the pig roast. Live and silent auction was over 250 items and some events that had money paid back and a portion going to the family. It was so amazing how many people came through to help and donate. Our place was packed with about 300 people and it was just amazing. We raised over $10,000 for the family. But no good deed goes unpunished though. Or that's what Karen had thought anyway. Within a couple days, we got a letter in the mail to cease and desist all activities from the township. I was visited by the police and health department. I also received a call from the youth association we had hosted the event for. He stated that Karen had called him threatening that she would sick her lawyer on him. She was yelling that the event was so disruptive that the loudspeakers we had shook her house. There was only one problem. Our speakers were not functioning great on the day of the event. The kids struggled to hear because they were cutting in and out. The event was held on the opposite side of the property from her house, with my house being in between them. I couldn't even hear the speakers in my house. I got a visit from the health department and she stated that we had multiple campers on the property that were dumping their black water on the ground and completely trashed the place. That we were serving food to the public and that I didn't have a food service license. The first thing the health department agent noticed is how clean my place was. We walked out to where people were parked and it was clear that no one had dumped anything on the ground. There wasn't even a napkin on the ground at the place. When she asked about the food and if the event was by invitation, I said, well, technically yes. I created an event on Facebook and made a flyer, and in big bold letters on the top of the flyer was, "You're invited." Because the event was private and invitational, those rules didn't apply to us. The cops came to tell us that someone had turned around in Karen's front yard and caused damage. However, when they got there to see the damage, she claimed that her husband had already fixed it. I attempted to go and talk to Karen and try to settle the issues like adults. I told her that I was sorry if anyone caused damage to her yard and wanted to rectify the issues. Before I could get everything out, she started cussing at me like a sailor. I just looked at her in my best customer service voice and said, for a grandmother who totes how important she is, that she sure had a foul mouth and that I refused to stand there and listen to that, and I walked away. Now for the township, this is where my love of research and my FBI tendencies come to play. They scheduled a hearing to discuss the matter. I showed up with 3 2-inch-thick 3-ring binders. Karen was sitting there right next to the township lawyer, looking all smug and entitled like she had won already. The township opened the hearing and she immediately got up and ranted about the events we were holding at our home. She said these events draw drugs and alcohol and bad behavior, and those events needed to be seized. I stood up and pleaded my case and told them that I was covered under the previously mentioned ACT and that there was nothing they could do, as it specifically stated that agriculture events were allowed. The events we hosted for youth that have to maintain a certain grade point average to participate, and if they are caught doing any of those things, they are kicked. I also read an email that the president of the event emailed to me about his interaction with Karen, and he also reiterated the rules of the event. After I was done, a man stood up and he ended up being our hero. He stated that he lived on the other side of Karen and he had no issues with the event. And also, he didn't appreciate getting a letter in his mailbox that wasn't stamped or properly mailed by Karen. Apparently, Karen put letters in all the neighbors' mailboxes pleading for all of them to show up for the hearing and to vote against us. The hero was mad and made a point to tell her that she's lucky he didn't call the law, as it's illegal to put unposted mail into someone's mailbox. The best part was after he was done speaking, he looked at me and said, "I will get you a copy of this letter." Karen tried to grab the letter out of the hero's hand and he said, "Excuse me, what are you doing?" She says, "That's my letter and I would like that back." The hero looked at her like she was crazy and told her, "Bad chance." The look on Karen's face after that was priceless. The board discussed the matter and it was 8-2 in our favor. After the meeting, we talked to the hero outside for a few minutes and shook his hand and thanked him for coming and speaking up. He told us that Karen thinks she can control everything because of the business they own, and it was a pleasure to help see her fall on her face. The township tried to find something to get us in trouble for, but couldn't. Their lawyer, persuaded by Karen, called me a few times to provide proof of how I was covered under the ACT. After a few phone calls with him, I told him that I don't have to prove anything as I was advised by the local agriculture agency. He had to prove how I wasn't covered under the ACT and file a civil case if he found so. Well, needless to say, I never heard anything from the township or Karen again. I apparently was the talk of the neighbors of how a little girl, as Karen called me, took her down. I was in my early 30s at the time, so not sure how I was a little girl, but I'll take it. Since this has happened, I have helped other people that are fighting with townships in our area, and I became well-versed in how the laws can work in their favor.
And now we have reached the end of today's stories. Thank you for watching and see you next time.